All right. Thank you very much for the presentations. Again, let me start by complimenting the professionalism of the attorneys, both the state and the defense. These are tough cases, and it's nearly an impossible feat. We ask attorneys to engage in zealously representing their clients, fighting in court. Sometimes it becomes personal, but the mark of professionalism is to have these very sharp disputes resolved in a professional appropriate manner, and I want to compliment both the state, the defense, in their zealous representation and maintaining a high level of professionalism. I get to see lots of trials, lots of lawyering. I get to see very good lawyering, and sometimes I get to see lawyering that's not so good, but I did witness an extremely high level of quality of representation for both sides and professionalism, and I very much appreciate that. I want to thank you for that. All right, let me begin by sharing with the parties that the jury has found you guilty, Ms. Dippolito, of solicitation to commit first-degree murder. In Florida, that's a first-degree felony. The maximum penalty for that is 30 years in the Department of Corrections. And then the legislature has also created guidelines that consider the crime that you've committed and then add on additional points for crimes that you may have committed in your past, which are not. And so the only score that you have on your score sheet is this crime. And the legislature, through the guidelines, has recommended a presumptive minimum sentence of 4 years in the Department of Corrections, 48 months. And was that changed by the guideline score sheet you handed up, or was that the same thing?
That's the
same thing. Okay, good. That hasn't changed. So my task is to figure out what an appropriate sentence would be, somewhere between 48 months and 30 years in the Department of Corrections. Here are some factors that are considered, and Mr. Salnick alluded to them. The first thing is, in no particular order, I don't know if it's the first thing, but it's the first thing I'm getting to, and that is deterrence. And there's two types of deterrence. There's individual deterrence, and that is to impose a sentence to tell an individual person, don't do that again. And they won't be tempted to do it again because they were punished. Then there's general deterrence. And general deterrence is everybody else watching what sentence is imposed. And so a person watching a sentence be imposed will say, ooh, I'm not going to do that because that's a punishment that I might get if I commit that act. The next factor that we consider when we're trying to impose an appropriate sentence is rehabilitation. How to rehabilitate somebody, and that's a factor that I consider in this thing. And what does that mean in this case? How do I rehabilitate you from what you have done? And I think that's a function of spinning your moral compass. I think your moral compass is askew. I think that it's something that. It's not like getting a drug addict off drugs or an alcoholic off alcohol, but rehabilitation, I hope that occurs as part of this sentence. A big variable, and the one that's most conspicuous, is punishment. You impose a sentence to punish bad behavior, criminal behavior, and that's going to be a large component of this sentence. And also a valid factor in imposing a sentence is retribution. And retribution is giving society the vent, the outlet, the sense of that person got what he or she had coming. And that's an appropriate variable to consider, although I'm not putting any sort of much weight on that aspect of it at all. It is something that is validly considered. So I consider those factors and try to figure out what weighs most in tailoring a sentence for you. And it has to do with the facts of the case, and it has to do with who you are and what you were thinking. And here's the way I see it. I think that a lot of it is what were your motivations? What were you doing? What were you thinking when that was going on? And I just come to the most obvious conclusion that you were motivated by greed, by avarice, that you were motivated by lust for another person, that you were motivated by your desire to be free of your husband, and that desire started manifesting itself about 2-3 months after y'all were married. And the sad thing for me is that there is absolutely no moral justification for your conduct. There's no evidence that you were being beaten and you were defending yourself, that you were a battered wife, that you were an alcoholic, that you were the victim of child abuse, that you were somehow acting in defense of yourself, even under a misguided notion. There's none of that here. All of your conduct was just for self-indulgence and just trying to take every bit of money that you could get a hold of so that you could go on and live this fast life. Now, Mr. Selnick tries to allude that you had this lifestyle before you met Mr. Dippolito that was pristine and moral. And maybe so. I don't know about your behaviors before you met Mr. Dippolito, but I think it's folly to suggest that you somehow were pure of heart on the day that you met Mr. Dippolito back on October 2008, and then somehow being exposed to him for 2 months caused you to plunge into some sort of moral decay that caused you to become a would-be murderess. I just don't buy that. I don't buy that. I think that was, notwithstanding everything your mom and your family tried to give you, that was who you became, who you were, and it manifested itself in these horrible acts. You met and married a man, and shortly after the honeymoon, you set about trying to get him arrested and thrown in jail for a violation of probation, trumping up charges, planting drugs on his car, having others call the police, trying to get his probation officer involved in it. In as early as March, you began this relentless campaign to get rid of your husband. First, you're thinking, well, I'll just get him sent off to prison and that would be good enough. You used guile and sophistry to dupe others into your web of deception. You were the puppet master that was pulling all the strings. You weren't acting at the direction of somebody else. You weren't under the influence of somebody else. You were the one calling the shots. And you were engaged in a course of conduct, not over some momentary lapse of good judgment. This wasn't like, I ran a red light, I shouldn't have done that. Or, what was I thinking? I had the gun in my hand and I shot it because I was angry. It was weeks and months that you continued with these different schemes to try to rid yourself of your husband that was just something out of a novel. And it was horrible to watch it unfold as the trial testimony came out. It was pure evil. You were taking advantage of a guy that was gullible, that was in love with you, and you contrived these elaborate plans and cajoled others to assist you in these efforts that were unwitting participants in your plan, and they didn't work. When the Green Acres Police Department failed to find the drugs that you had orchestrated being planted on the car failed, bad on the Manalapan Police Department, but then you tried it again and had drugs planted on the car again. And you had the West Palm Beach Police Department find it. And it was so preposterous that, you know, law enforcement, not known to give drug dealers who are on probation a break, they didn't buy it. It was so ludicrous what was going on. And they let your husband go at that point. Still, it goes on. And Mr. Dippolito looking for a guard dog, that didn't seem, I don't know how Mr. Selnick was trying to suggest that was somehow, offensive, but I believe Mr. Dippolito during the trial when he said, I don't know what was going on, I don't know who was coming to try to get me, someone's trying to plant drugs on my car. I'm not sure how much he suspected you had anything to do with it at that time, but in any event, that seemed kind of reasonable. He put the alarms on and was trying to protect himself any way he could. After those attempts to have your husband taken out of the picture by way of sending him back to prison for a long period of time, and when you learned that it wasn't good enough to have the house in your name, that if you wanted to sell the house, you were still going to need his signature, I think that's when it started to turn to even more sinister behavior. That's when it was that that the plot to have him killed started to take form. During this time, it was when your husband was trying to make restitution, and I don't think he was motivated because he was pure of heart. He wanted to have some quid pro quo. He wanted to get assurance that if I give this money up, I'm going to get off probation. Not completely unreasonable, but his motivations were for self-interest and not because of some altruistic desire to compensate the victims. But I think that that's when you saw close to $200,000 of cash money assets about ready to leave your clutches. And that's when things started heating up. And that's when entered Mohammed Shihada and his effort to help you initially try to line somebody up to kill your husband. And then when things started getting out of hand, I think Mr. Shihada got cold feet, recognizing he probably would have been on the hook for part of this murder. And that's when he contacted Boynton Beach Police. And so fortunately, no help of your own, the Boynton Beach Police Department came in and collected the evidence of your true intent, and that was to have your husband murdered. Murdered. And the state's right, Ms. Parker's right. If it had been successful, this certainly would have been a case where the death penalty would have been a real possibility. And so, to that extent, the fact that you were caught and Mr. Dippolito was not murdered, one, Mr. Dippolito was not murdered, and two, you're not facing either life in prison or the death penalty. So those are the factors some of the factors that I've considered. A couple of other things is I find it disingenuous that it was always your desire to give the house back. The videotape when you got caught and the telephone calls that were recorded from jail where you were telling your mother, get him out of my house, and turning over the quitclaim deed here in court at this moment is a little more than grandstanding. If you wanted to give him the house back, you would have given him the house back long, long ago. You didn't need lawyers. You didn't need anything other than someone maybe to help you understand how to fill out a quitclaim deed, which you had participated in before. But if it was truly in your heart to give him the house back, all you had to do was give him the house back with no strings attached. But you, I think, were trying to, you know, try to maximize the play on giving the house back. So I appreciate that you, and through your attorney, have given it back. It seems appropriate. And maybe Mr. Dippolito's right that he was going to get it back anyway, no matter what, but that seems reasonable. But in any event, that's one less issue to have to haggle over in the divorce court. Mr. Salnick indicates that, you know, being remorseful or saying I'm sorry really doesn't mean anything. And I disagree. I disagree. I think even today, Mr. Dippolito, still your husband, I think that I'm sorry, it's my fault, I did it, would have gone a long way, not only for his healing, but it would have perhaps suited your own purpose. But I haven't heard anything. I haven't heard an ounce of remorse, the opposite of that. When confronted with the obvious facts, the most powerful testimony as to who you are is when you were in the police station and your husband walked by and looked in and you were begging him, tell him this is all wrong, tell him this is all wrong. And then later on the telephone, you were saying, he was confronting you with the evidence. I saw the tapes. I saw the videotape of you trying to have me killed. And you just cold-bloodedly said to him, I saw what you saw and I'm telling you that's not true. And it was astonishing. The cold-blooded denial that you're willing to go to try to avoid the obvious. And so it you are different people to different people. You have a certain facet of who you are with your mom, your sister, your brother, and they see the good in you. As siblings and parents should. But who you are when no one's looking, other than a camera in a police car, is quite different. And I think that peers deeply into your soul and speaks volumes of the way you were presenting this, and it was quite chilling to witness that. Based upon those factors, then, Ms. Dippolito, I'll accept the verdict of the jury. I'll find you guilty. I'll adjudicate you guilty. And I'm sentencing you to 20 years in the Department of Corrections. I'll give you credit for all the time that you've been on in-house arrest. I'll subtract that out. I'm not obligated to do that, but I'll give you credit for that.
Thank you, Your Honor.
So that would be from the day of arrest. So from the day of arrest through today's date, we'll come off of the sentence. And I wish you well. I hope things turn around for you. I hope you're able to make something of your life. You're a young woman. You'll get out of prison. You'll be a changed person, and hopefully you will take that opportunity at that time to make the most out of what remains ahead of you. I don't think restitution is appropriate. I'm not sure that, let me do it this way. I'll order restitution. I'll let you all flesh that out. I don't think that there's enough of a nexus between the crime and the money lost by Mr. Dippolito. As much as my heart goes out to him, I think he was fleeced as a gullible husband, but I don't think that it's a matter of restitution. But for the record, I'll say restitution, parties to either agree to an amount. Otherwise, I'll leave it. I'll reserve jurisdiction on that for 30 days. If nobody approaches me, the amount of restitution will be zero. What I'd be interested in is first from the state proving an entitlement to restitution. I don't think you are, but I'll leave the door open for you. I'll also impose the mandatory court costs and I'll reduce that to a judgment. Anything else, State, that you wish for me to do?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Thank you so much. We're in recess.